All Gold Canyon by Jack London, narrated by Peter Coates. It was the green heart of the canyon, where the walls swerved back from the rigid plan and relieved their harshness of line by making a little sheltered nook and filling it to the brim with sweetness and roundness and softness. Here all things rested. Even the narrow stream ceased its turbulent downrush long enough to form a quiet pool. Knee-deep in the water, with drooping head and half-shut eyes, drowsed a red-coated, many-antlered buck. On one side, beginning at the very lip of the pool, was a tiny meadow, a cool, resilient surface of green that extended to the base of the frowning wall. Beyond the pool, a gentle slope of earth ran up and up to meet the opposing wall. Fine grass covered the slope, grass that was spangled with flowers, with here and there patches of colour, orange and purple and golden. Below, the canyon was shut in. There was no view. The walls leaned together abruptly and the canyon ended in a chaos of rocks, moss-covered, and hidden by a green screen of vines and creepers and boughs of trees. Up the canyon rose far hills and peaks, the big foothills, pine-covered and remote. And far beyond, like clouds upon the border of the sky, towered minarets of white, where the Sierra's eternal snows flashed austerely the blazes of the sun. There was no dust in the canyon. The leaves and flowers were clean and virginal. The grass was young velvet. Over the pool, three cottonwoods sent their snowy fluffs fluttering down the quiet air. On the slope, the blossoms of the wine-wooded manzanita filled the air with springtime odors, while the leaves, wise with experience, were already beginning their vertical twist against the coming aridity of summer. In the open spaces on the slope, beyond the farthest shadow reach of the manzanita, poised the mariposa lilies, like so many flights of jeweled moths, suddenly arrested and on the verge of trembling into flight again. Here and there, that wood's harlequin, the madrona, permitting itself to be caught in the act of changing its pea-green trunk to madder red, breathed its fragrance into the air from great clusters of waxen bells. Creamy white were these bells, shaped like lilies of the valley, with the sweetness of perfume that is of the springtime. There was not a sigh of wind. The air was drowsy with its weight of perfume. It was a sweetness that would have been cloying had the air been heavy and humid, but the air was sharp and thin. It was as starlight transmuted into atmosphere, shot through and warmed by sunshine, and flower-drenched with sweetness. An occasional butterfly drifted in and out through the patches of light and shade, and from all about rose the low and sleepy hum of mountain bees, feasting sybarites that jostled one another good-naturedly at the board, nor found time for rough discourtesy. So quietly did the little stream drip and ripple its way through the canyon that it spoke only in faint and occasional gurgles. The voice of the stream was as a drowsy whisper, ever interrupted by dozings and silences, ever lifted again in the awakenings. The motion of all things was a drifting in the heart of the canyon. Sunshine and butterflies drifted in and out among the trees, the hum of the bees, and the whisper of the stream were a drifting of sound, and the drifting sound and drifting colour seemed to weave together in the making of a delicate and intangible fabric, which was the spirit of the place. It was a spirit of peace that was not of death, but of smooth pulsing life, of quietude that was not silence, of movement that was not action, of repose that was quick with existence, without being violent with struggle and travail. The spirit of the place was the spirit of the peace of the living, somnolent with the easement and contentment of prosperity, and undisturbed by rumours of far wars. The red-coated, many-antlered buck acknowledged the lordship of the spirit of the place and dozed knee-deep in the cool, shaded pool. There seemed no flies to vex him.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.